You say that your sort of conditioning in life, from whether it was in your childhood or whether it was through football, was just to be a bit tougher and not really go anywhere near the emotional stuff.
Yeah, showing emotion in my house was never. I never saw my dad and my mum really sit on a sofa like this together.
Mm, really?
So I never really saw affection and love like that. And going into a change room in the environment, especially at Manchester United, where it's just about winning, if you saw any of the guys that looked a little bit emotionally unstable, it'd have been, right, they're not good for us, because that means we might not win.
But that meant you couldn't celebrate the highs either. So this wasn't just detaching yourself from bad things. This was, even if you won, you didn't get that excited about it.
Yeah, because you had a good night, but you didn't dwell on it. Like, for instance, we won the Champions League. That night, I'm speaking to the CEO saying, who are we buying? Who are we buying? He's looking at me like, enjoy it. But I was always thinking of the next step, and I think that to sustain a level of winning, you can't sit there and look back and enjoy the moment too often, and that's the way I was scared of that.
Because you said in the book you wish you had been more open, you wish you'd communicated more, you wished you'd said I love you more to Rebecca.
Yeah, and the same with my mum. And I think that at the beginning especially, they're the type of things that would keep you up at night, and they were the things that would kind of stick around your mind. And I think that's why in my relationship now and with my children, I don't want to make that same mistake again, because, God forbid, if something was to happen, I want to be comfortable and know that that person and them kids know exactly how I am and how I feel. But I need to... That's a work in progress right now, and I'm trying to work on that to make sure that mistake...
Can you be both things, though? Can you be emotional and loving? Because doesn't that sort of unfocus you from the job you had to do?
Yeah, I think balance is the key word. You've got to try and find that balance. But my fear was always, if I'd done it again, I would aim to leave all of that intensity at the front door.
Yeah. Mm.
But my fear was, if I still went to the front door and I became a little bit more calm and relaxed and didn't think about it, I would lose something, lose that edge when I went and played football. So that was always my fear. So I think it's difficult, but I think most successful people are really driven, and that intensity kind of takes over their lives and becomes all-consuming.
So how easy is that for you to do then, having lived a whole life like that, from being a child all the way through adulthood? Are you better at that now in your relationships with your children? Do you feel like you're more open with your emotions now?
Yeah, and I've said to them from the beginning, it's OK to cry. It's OK to be open. Yeah. Daddy cries. They look at me like sometimes like big macho man in the house. Daddy's can do this, Daddy can do that, but it is okay to cry, and that's what I've always tried to stress to them. If you've got anything to speak about, or it doesn't make you any less of a boy or a girl, you can speak and be open, and just because once you do that, I've realised that it does release a lot of stress
so
and
important.
Tension.
How did you open that dialogue with the kids? What was the first time you said, because you're not used to saying that sort of thing, it's okay to cry, I just had a cry?
Yeah, it was. I think one of them was in Portugal, really, when we was at the house, and just I was really searching for some answers on how they were feeling emotionally, and I just said to them, listen, it is okay. And one of my boys did actually break down and start crying and stuff, but it's hard, and I think that it's hard for me, because that's not the way I've been conditioned. I'm not wired to do that naturally, and so I'm trying to do that and incorporate it in our everyday life.
She's very organised, Rebecca. She's a terribly organised person, and she bought a whole load of notebooks. Sadly, didn't have the time to write in them, because you were looking at those notebooks and thinking, right, OK, I would hope if there was something in here, it's going to be the answers to the big questions. Can Tia have her ears pierced? Mm. You know, what's the story with girlfriends? All of those answers you had to figure out yourself.
Yeah, and it was a blank book in the end, because she didn't get that far. And that's why the second time round with my mum, which unfortunately happened so quick after, I made sure that I sat down with my mum and got lists written out about what she wanted for my brothers and sisters, for her husband, for my grandkids, my brother's grandkids, her grandkids, and just even the planning of her own funeral, which is hard to do, but I thought, I regretted not doing that before. I'm not going to make the same mistake again. Well, most dads get up and say, yeah, I'm doing a school run. That's the part, probably 10% of that morning, and we think we're doing probably 90%. And we go out saying, yeah, we are the big I ams. And then when I realised, I had to wake up and I was having panic attacks in the morning, thinking, I've not planned from the night before. Where's the ties? Where's their socks? Where's their homework? What homework are they meant to have done? What class have they got after school? And like, you end up being late and you're sitting there going, wow, that is a job in itself, just the morning, let alone...
Yeah, but
and you can't work the washing machine.
Oh, yeah, but I'm lucky I've got a good network of people around as well, friends and family that do help, so I can't take all the credit.
Who showed you how to work the washing machine?
Well, I'll bypass that.
Still doesn't know.
I went and saw Darren Clark, the golfer, and there were so many parallels in our lifestyles, the way it was, the way athletes being away. And he just sat there and said, listen, you will be happy again. You will be smiling again. You will be as happy as you was before. And for someone who'd been through the same walk as me and walked them steps, to hear that really hit home. And then that was last year. Mm. And then it made me open up, because before that, I wasn't capable of opening up to anybody emotionally, and I didn't see it, I wouldn't accept it, I didn't want to bring anyone around my children. Whereas now, especially after that meeting, it really did make me feel, listen, there is maybe an opportunity to be happy again, and I'm really happy now. My kids deserve to be happy. They've had tragedy for the last few years in their life.
Well, tricky for Kate as well coming in, isn't it? Just making sure you get the, balance
right. They have to be part of that conversation, so there's not been at any stage where going into this relationship where they've not been involved, that even in terms of the introducing, how do you want it to be done? Basic stuff that you'd take for granted. As long as they feel they're involved and they're in that conversation, I think that there's a chance that you can get to that place of happiness. But I will always make sure that they're at the beginning of any conversation to do with anything that can have an effect on their life.